10:50, and then Mickey Rourke, Ellen Barkin and Kevin Bacon in Diner at Midnight 20. Just some of the many stars who made it big in the 80s.
Welcome to 1984, a year to fear according to science fiction fans. George Orwell's novel predicted a nightmarish vision of the future, and this was the year it was all meant to come horribly true. We'd been told that in 1984, Big Brother would be watching us all, but as it turned out, he was more likely to be tuning into the A-Team and Robin of Sherwood.
And so I face the war, turn my back against it all. How I wish I had been unborn, wish I was a living sex crime.
Now here's a piece of trivia you might appreciate. George Peppard was the original choice to be Blake Carrington in Dynasty. Had things turned out differently, he could have spent his final years resting his head on Joan Collins' shoulder pads. As it is, Peppard is best remembered as the leader of the least convincing group of mercenaries ever assembled, the A-Team. How bad could the B and C teams have been?
10 years ago, a crack commando unit was sent to prison by a military court for a crime they didn't commit. These men promptly escaped from maximum security stockade to the Los Angeles underground. Today, still wanted by the government, they survive as soldiers of fortune. If you have a problem, if no one else can help, and if you can find them, maybe you can hire the A-Team.
Bum ba da bum.
A-Team.
The A-Team was like one of the most interesting creations that I was ever involved with. Every character we tried to make dysfunctional. Howling Mad Murdoch, that lives in a mental institution and you don't know whether he's really crazy or faking it.
Well, they don't let crazy people vote. They take that right away from you when you commit it.
And Face Man, the pathological liar who can't tell you the truth at gunpoint.
Well, I...
Hannibal, if he wasn't just on the verge of getting everybody killed, it was no fun for him.
He said, your mother works street corners and you're so ugly, flies wouldn't land on you. I told you it wasn't very nice. He also said that you're a chicken-hearted lowlife who sleeps in pig slop, and your sister...
Okay, I get the point.
And then B.A. Baracus, an angry black guy who hated everybody without a prejudice. And that was our team.
Well, kid, looks like you just hired the A-Team.
What kind of platoon would they have been? There was four of them. And George Peppard was about 52, but the other two blokes were obviously about 26. And then there's Mr. T. You just think, no, come on, they must have had more strict regulations than that, even during the Vietnam War. Not like anybody want to join the army.
I miss riding over the North 40 Sunday mornings.
I wanted somebody that was a rogue. I wanted somebody that when he smiled, he had the devil in his smile and in his eyes. And who better than George?
Nice though, isn't it?
George Peppard. Breakfast at Tiffany's. He went from being Audrey Hepburn's lover to being Hannibal. Amazing.
The first thing George said to me in the trailer, first day in makeup, hello, I'm George Peppard. I'm not a very nice man.
George had a pretty bad rep, you know, as a guy that, you know, that could cause trouble when you once you had him in your show.
Who the hell is that? Where'd that moron come from?
Now, Cannell always hired difficult actors.
He came to me one day and he said, these long working hours are sort of untenable and it's going to be pretty hard for me to, you know, to stay much beyond 5 o'clock.
One of the producers, John Ashley, word came to the set that he had had a heart attack. George comes walking back in his little running suit, all dressed in his duds and his little black bag. He said, "News about John Ashley was just too much for me. I'm going home, pal. If it can happen to John, it can happen to me. I'm not working past 5 o'clock anymore."
"I got one more shot and I'm through. Now watch this. I think I got a real handle on my character here."
So now, it was as if he had a contractual, he acted as if it was in his contract.
Cannell knew that this was going to happen. He knew about it. I mean, he knew that there was going to be this 5 o'clock thing. And then T said, "Well, George's going at 5, I'm going at 5.
"But you ain't no actor. You don't find actors dressing up like lizards."
"It's a very narrow interpretation, B.A. Boris Karloff wouldn't like it."
I used to love Mr. T and the A-Team.
"Believe it, because every word is true.
Shut up, fool! That's what Mr. T used to say. Shut up, fool! I ain't getting on no damn plane!
I'm getting tired of this rap, Murdoch."
"You're tired of it. How do you think I feel? I have to listen to it all day."
Mr. T did not trust Murdoch and wouldn't get in a plane with him at all. He was a bit like kind of the Dennis Bergkamp of his time.
And they'd have to drug him to get on a plane.
"Turn right up there."
And he never figured it.
"I think I'll get out for a minute."
"This road leads directly to the airport, Hannibal."
They'd come up to him every episode. They'd all crowd around and go, "Mr. T, drink this." And he wouldn't go, "Why are you all standing here waiting for me?" He'd go, "Okay."
"Ah, here's the luggage, kid."
They're the A-Team.
You know they're soldiers of fortune.
They're the A-Team.
Helping people in need. You can pretend that you're Hannibal, Murdoch, or Face, or maybe B.A. Baracus. You know each one is an ace.
This is a hard thing to have to admit. We told the same story 100 times. Because the story, the breadth of the storytelling was so narrow on that show in order to make it work.
That was...
same mission every week, absolutely.
Absolutely the same mission
And they
every
always
week.
Got out with a lawnmower and a long pipe and some sort of fertilizer.
Things like a stapler, a couple of matchboxes, and a bicycle pump. And you just see them all doing things like, and they're suddenly wearing goggles and welding, and then suddenly, like, they'd pull back and they'd have an incredible, like, mortar built on wheels and a little tank to drive it around.
And they blew up everything, blew up cars, bombed people, shot people. Nobody ever died in the A-Team. Did you notice that?
There'd be a flurry of machine gun fire from pretty close range. And they'd miss. And so I just think that as a baddie, you must think, it's okay, guys. It's the A-Team. I think we're going to be okay.
He had big hair, didn't he? Orange, was it? Kind of curtain around like that.
Well, the word was, like, amongst musicians that he was very talented.
And they could never understand a word of what his songs were about.
Wow. He used to wear gloves, didn't he?
"So bring on the dancing girls. Take off the cold night and the sad day. Bring on the dancing girls."
You've got to remember that I was a muso. I played in a fusion band for years and years, a functions band. I used to stand at the back in my jeans and my t-shirt and pint of lager and I was happy, you know. And then I wrote a few songs and it was like, "Get out of there." Yeah. Center of attention. I was like a startled rabbit for about 2 years.
Life's demands with nothing to believe.
Well, him and Howard Jones were just like the same bloke though, weren't they, really? The sort of records were sort of interchangeable and all that sort of stuff.
You either like one or the other. I was on Nick Kershaw's side because Howard Jones' music was so odd, and he had that, remember he had a bloke dancing with him at the beginning called Jed. "Throw off your mental chains," he used to sing that, but and Jed obviously had well thrown off his mental chains.
"I won't let the sun go down on me. I won't let the sun..." Not right. "Go down, Western Supermer, Burnham-on-Sea.
in a big ballroom doing it, me and my mum.
I hated that song, absolutely hated that record.
I'm walling the sun go down on me. I'm walling the sun go down.
Originally when I wrote it, it was just a really kind of mellow folk song with a guitar and like a protest song, you know. And it's my fault, I turned it into a like this cheesy pop anthem.
The riddle about an old man of Arran going round and around. What?
There is a tree by a river and who gives a shit.
Near a tree by a river, there's a hole in the ground where an old man of Arran goes around and around. Obviously. And it's bollocks, isn't it?
Wise men say, near a tree by a river, there's a hole in the ground where an old man of Arran goes around and around, and his mind is a beacon.
The thing is, what is the riddle? You know, what is the answer?
We went in the studio and we started recording it, and put this gibberish down as a guide vocal, and it just stayed there because I never came up with any lyrics. But everybody loved it, so you can't get rid of it. It doesn't mean anything. It's all right, we'll call it the riddle.
And apparently there wasn't any answer, you just kind of made it up. So, you know, he spent 20 years trying to find the answer to Nick Kershaw's song, and then he comes along and says, there wasn't any. I just made it up.
It got to a point that I couldn't own up, because I'd get, like, pages and pages of stuff from fans and people that have, like, spent their lives working out what the riddle was about.
You'll never, never fight over you. No,
1984, I would say, was the real beginning of the role of the stylist in pop, where someone would actually buy your clothes.
And everybody had a stylist in those days. Everybody had a stylist. But I think we all had the same one.
Stylists started to become almost as important as hairdressers at the time, or people on the door at clubs.
You're there, and it's like they're putting this stuff on you, and you're going... You look in the mirror and you go, I think, I don't know about that. And they go, that's fantastic. Everyone's going, yeah. That's it. Rock God. And you're going, wanker.
I got it bad. You don't know how bad I got it.
I had to go and mention the S word. The snood was a roll of material which you just whacked over your head, or your stylist whacked over your head.
Some people don't remember snoods at all. I remember them so clearly because I thought they were so horrible.
I wore it maybe four or five times in the space of like the first 6 or 8 weeks when it all went crazy. So I walked on stage on the first gig of the tour and it's like, it's a sea of snoods.
I mean, I will admit to leg warmers. I did do the leg warmers thing, but the snood thing, no way.
It was for just one day.
And fingerless gloves as well, they were. That was the other thing. I remember my promotions man being very upset that I wasn't wearing the fingerless gloves on the first gig, until it was pointed out to him that it's actually quite difficult to play guitar with gloves on.
To be on your side.
With hindsight, if I'd like to change anything about the 80s, I would have acquired a sense of humour a bit earlier on. I think we all took ourselves so seriously. It was such a pose from start to finish.
You must be joking, you don't know a thing about it.
For many, the rite of passage that is attending your first proper disco can be a distressing and embarrassing one. Will I cop off? Will my clothes look alright? Will anyone dance with me? Are all dilemmas for the disco virgin. So pity the poor souls who hit the floor for the first time in 84 and found out they'd have to wear roller skates as well.
What seems so funny about the advent of roller disco is it's hard enough trying to pick someone up. And how much more of a wanker do you want to make yourself look? I'm going to pop roller skates on and then try and get off with a girl.
Mainly just skate round and round and round and round and round and round and round.
Me and my best friend Melanie, we used to just go around on our roller boots all the time, sort of like chasing boys.
You always went with a view to kind of flirting with the boys, or, you know, trying to sort of get together with the guy you've had your eye on.
It was brilliant because you'd had all the kind of top hits, but you'd be roller skating.
Saturday night roller skating at the Town Hall, Torquay. At the moment we're at our peak and we are getting some 400 kids in the hall, and obviously when you get that amount of people enjoying themselves at the same time, the atmosphere is unique and it is absolutely electric.
It's run by 17-year-old Sarah Green.
Everybody knew who I was, and even now people go, "Oh, you're Sarah, you're the girl who used to run the roller skating." And it just got busier and busier. The bouncer used to put his feet against the door and put his feet up against the queue for fear of them pushing the door in.
For years I used to do mobile discos, and the roller skating rink opened up in our town. It was easier because you could play anything and people would still go around in circles. You didn't actually have to work too hard to make them do anything.
Hello.
A lot of the skates then were yellow and blue for some reason. You could only buy yellow and blue skates, which didn't always go with the black eyeliner and, you know, all the rest of it.
Look how they're made in the factory.
My roller boots were fantastic. They were blue and yellow and they were from Blythe Market. And they were great and they had big yellow wheels and everything else was blue and all the stitching was yellow.
But it was fatally flawed as an arena for dating, because the girls were actually quite good and you'd sort of find them going in the slipstream around the edges and quite cool, and boys sipping Coke at the side because they weren't that good.
And the only guys I knew who looked cool roller skating were gay ones. I never met a straight man who looked good roller skating. You'd be going, "Whoa!" You'd be round, and you'd be going, "Hi!" And you'd be off, you know. And you'd hope that they were there when you got back round again.
Or occasionally they'd propel themselves from the side of the ring just across as quick as they possibly could go. And maybe occasionally they would have to knock the objects of their affections onto the ground because they had no other way of stopping.
Everybody's bumping into everybody, so guys soon learned that, you know, if they went around really fast and bumped into somebody, they'd soon be lying on top of the girl of their choice.
When it comes to icons of children's TV, they don't come much bigger than Tucker Jenkins. A nation mourned when he finally left Grange Hill and wondered, would we ever see him again?
What is going on now?
Nothing, sir. Honest.
All right.
Oh! What are you doing down there?
I'm just checking for cracks, miss.
Everywhere I went to talk about Grange Hill with kids, the first question they'd say is, "Well, why did Tucker have to go?" Second question, "Where is he now?" You know.
They said, "What do you think about following Tucker and his mates after school, signing on, chasing girls?" And I said, "Yeah, sounds good to me." So I went for it.
Three 16, 17-year-old lads just out of school, looking for adventure and looking for a job. And looking for a job. And looking for a job. Constantly.
I think it was a time when there was a lot about all the YTS, all the YOP schemes and that kind of thing. So I think we'd left school with not many qualifications and it was just sort of doing the old signing on bit.
You should have been here an hour ago.
Why? What happened?
Your box was closed.
Yeah, well, I didn't have no money for the bus. I'm out of work, you see.
Life was getting tough for kids, you know, and the economy was closing down, you know. And I thought it would be very realistic for a character like Everyman Tucker to be struggling.
Next, please.
It's not my fault there's no crappy jobs.
And it's not my fault you can't get out of bed once a fortnight.
I was a huge Tucker fan. I used to absolutely love Tucker Jenkins. Because he was the cool one who wore the jeans and the leather jacket and he was almost like Britain's answer to the Fonz.
Tucker! See me dinner time!
When you're in a tube train with 20 or 30 girls shouting at you, there's not really much you can do. You can either laugh or cry, and I laugh most of the time.
You know, my dad thinks it'll go out with someone like Prince Charles. It does, honey.
I really didn't like it that much. I think because he was so important to me as a character in Grange Hill that when they took him out and put him in a different environment, and he just had his big fat friend with him as well, didn't he?
All right, issue this out for you. You're tasty.
Oh, she is. Will we fix you up with a dog?
I liked Alan, was a nice lad. Big Alan. I always felt sorry for Alan, really. It was that thing about one person always has sort of an ugly mate.
I suppose I was the minder, the big, soft fella.
I was just passing.
No, you weren't. You're practically a fixture on the gatepost lunchtimes.
Susie was my girlfriend in Grange Hill.
I'm going out with Steve now.
Alan the big dope just had his heart broken.
Well, sorry.
Poor Alan. So unfair, isn't it, life? I bet now, today, he's slim, gorgeous, with a beautiful wife and loads of wonderful children or something.
Passmore himself is your typical skinhead.
She's not in.
And he chased us round the whole of West London, I think, through that series. I've never run so much in all my life. Peter McNamara, lovely guy, absolutely brilliant. He used to live just around the corner from me at the time, and we used to meet up normally in Safeways of all places, and we'd stand and chat, and you know, you could have a lovely time with him, but you'd see people standing in Safeways going, "Are they talking? What's going on?"
I don't believe it.
What was all that about then?
Dunno, muggers?
One of the final scenes in Tucker's Luck, Tucker goes into an office as a courier. Trisha Yates is there. They hated each other at school.
Thanks.
Then I have to go back a couple of days later to give another package. Eyes start to twinkle.
You're Trisha Yates.
And you're Tucker Jenkins.
We're wondering, could it be possible?
Yeah. What are you doing tomorrow night?
Nothing special, why?
Well, do you want to come out for a drink?
Yeah, all right.
So who'd have thought it, eh? Tucker Jenkins and Trisha Yates.
These days she's called the Queen of Pop, a musical maverick and simply mad by people trying to annoy her. We're talking Madonna here, of course, but back in 1984, few people believed that a woman who looked like she struggled to dress herself in the morning would go on to rule our lives. Oh, how wrong they were.
She seemed like she was like you. She didn't seem too groomed. She seemed cheeky. She was attractive without being sophisticated.
Gorgeous, she can dance, she can do everything. Sexy.
She genuinely understood the power of image and exploited it to its fullest. In every nation. She sang Holiday and she did this dance, which I can demonstrate, which went kind of like that. And we thought it was brilliant, tried to copy that at home. Madonna's very early look, certainly when I, when we had a photo shoot with her, was black rags in the hair and black sort of sawn-off sweatshirts, black footless tights.
He was functional, I think, initially. The sexiness came on secondhand in the clothes, but Madonna was sexy, period, so one, you know, goes with the other.
Lots of bangles. And too many accessories, you know, not one belt but three, you know, not one bangle but 70.
Well, I describe it as very free and easy, very loose, lots of jewellery, lace. It's very undisciplined. She puts together just anything that she likes.
And all the chains, the kind of crosses and things. My dad tried to have a really serious conversation with me about it, going, do you really think it's wise to wear a cross? You know, isn't that wrong?
It was very much about movement, because she was an excellent dancer.
That was her early urban urchin slut period. It was always blatantly, everything was about sex, and her belly button, which she discussed freely and at length, more than the Dalai Lama discusses peace, Madonna discussed her belly button. I was beat,
incomplete. I've been had. All of a sudden, here comes someone singing like a virgin being touched for the very first time. And I think that the first time you sort of heard those lyrics, you couldn't believe it. It's like, wait, am I really, is this, they're going to put this out on the radio? Like a virgin.
Oh, and when Like a Virgin came out, that song, it was deathly at school. I mean, we were actually punished. You'd get sent to detention if you started to sing it. It was a real anti-Madonna thing going on there. Next
to mine. I remember that there was this talk of having a black outfit, black virgin, and I said, let's keep your purity. I mean, who's going to believe it anyway? But like a virgin, it's pretty obvious we go for a wedding dress. And because I wanted to mix also the rock thing, and, you know, the gloves were lace, but then I cut them off.
The video, again, was an object of great amusement for my friends and I. She's what, swanning through Venice and sort of writhing on top of a gondola and wearing a bridal gown, which no one could understand how she had returned to virginhood when clearly she was a woman of some experience.
Mandy Cutting is a college girl, lives in a bedsit in North London. Mum and Dad back home at Deal in Kent. For her, Madonna has opened the door to a new and more exhilarating way of life.
I like it because it makes people notice me, and I'm not just another one of the crowd.
It was a new craze, everyone had moved on from like the punk era, the new romantic era, and it was just like Madonna, Madonna crazy.
Outside the disco, come midnight, more Madonna fans are still queuing to get in, while the lookalike contest is reaching its noisy climax.
Right guys, Mandy, you want to take a walk?
Went in there and they said, oh, going for it, and I was going, no. They said, no, go for it, you'll win loads of prizes, you know, it'll be a laugh and everything. So I did, and I won.
I don't see myself as a boy toy. I go out to enjoy myself and I love teasing, but I could say I was a boy toy.
It's funny looking back, you always remember yourself, but when you actually get to see yourself, it's like, wow, did I really say that? Did I really do that? And I was thinking, yeah, I did. And at the time, that was me.
And for her, like Madonna, virtue clearly has its own rewards.
Good stuff.
Having followed Madonna's career and eventually interviewing her, you realise actually she's completely exceptional and there are very, very few people like her at all. But when she first started, she seemed like she was attainable and she seemed like that you could, you know, with just a few more bangles, you would be like her.
Amazing how you think about that, you know, now as we quite happily, you know, setting our videos left, right and centre for everything, the idea of, oh, you don't have to stay in and watch the telly. I mean, you go out and watch Top of the Pops when you come in. It was like the future had finally arrived.
Suddenly you were pestering your parents to get a video. No one wanted to go to the pictures anymore.
Cinemas closing throughout the country. A one-time 1,500 million cinema goers a year, now down to a mere 80 million. But undoubtedly the biggest threat lies here, the video film market.
And we got a video and I was just over the moon because me and Warren had stand talking at one and he had one. But he got beaten.
Oh! Have we got the video? Yes! We've got our video!
You sneered slightly at the people who had a Betamax who would always turn around and insist to you that, no, honestly, it's much better picture quality.
Well, the Betamax owners found themselves kind of ostracised, ultimately.
For some reason, and we didn't know anything about technology, but for some reason VHS was slightly cooler.
Top loader, silver, nobody could nick it because you couldn't lift it up and it just got, my dad had always put a cushion over the clock because it flashed when you went out and if anyone walking past they'd see it flashing they'd be in and rob it, but they couldn't lift it because it was enormous, it was like
You needed to be a weightlifter to be honest to operate some of these things, and big fat buttons you give a wallop and they shot up, you could sit on them and spring into the air kind of thing.
The ejector would be like, and our house used to shake when you just ejected from that, and in the middle of the night you'd be trying to watch a video, you know what I mean, and you'd be like rewind about forward, you're coming to bed, I'm watching a film, hang on, I'll be up in a minute.
Press play. Happy viewing.
Ha ha ha! They wouldn't say that if they knew what video we've got.
The video man would come round on a Friday evening to a mate's house with a huge box of videos, which myself and a couple of our friends would rifle through, trying to pull out the juiciest, most horrific films you could.
First we're going to have sex with the headless corpse of the Virgin Astronaut.
But the carpet get awfully sticky.
It's a video nasty!
I think I spent the whole 1980s watching video nasties. On Friday nights, we get about five of them. I exhausted the local video shop. I saw them all. My TV screen is sick and blood.
Video Nasty was pretty much speaking a horror movie, more likely than not of Italian origin, more likely than not low production values, but plenty of splatter in them and enough juicy bits to keep me and my mates happy for an hour and a half, or 20 minutes if we were watching it on fast forward. There's no
escape. There's no way. They weren't categorised in any particular way, they were just on the shelves. Nobody really knew what they were until they actually appeared in lists saying these films are video nasties.
What about stuff like The Living Dead and zombie flesh eaters and all that
stuff? They're stupid, they're not realistic, are they?
My mum don't really let me, but I watch them when she's not in.
Which do you prefer?
Me, I prefer horror films.
Why is that?
Because they're more scarier, more threatening and more blood.
The most 80s video nasty that I saw was Aerobicide, Working Out Can Be Murder, which was set in a gym. It was the most 80s thing you could possibly imagine. And they all died in gym-related ways. One of them got burnt to death on a sunbed. Another one, the weights fell on his head. And this killer just went around the gym knocking them all off. That was a brilliant film.
But they were never very good copies, because always, they were always got from, like, Big Roy at the British Legion. And you put it in, and it'd be like, you know, they're getting through a blizzard. Well, what's happening now?
Well, they don't call this a new era in television entertainment.
No, I call it very, very dull.
And a lot of these films were terribly, terribly boring.
My sister always used to have a Sunday afternoon, she'd watch horror films, and all her friends would come round and they'd watch things like The Burning and Driller Killer and Happy Birthday to Me and I Spit on Your Grave, and then we'd go, dinner's ready! Like, front room, like, door shut, watching all these video nasties. Falling on my head like a new emotion.
Are they? Aren't they? Torval and Dean left us in suspense. Their red-hot routine became the talk of the tabloids.
Everybody, I don't care how cynical you were in 1984, enjoyed watching Torval and Dean having sex on television.
Everybody remembers that performance. That was a great moment in sporting history, Torval and Dean. Everybody sort of went on about, you know, you can feel the electricity, and the bolero became this sort of big passionate number. Rubbish.
It was called erotic, but you know, we wouldn't find it erotic. It wasn't 9.5 weeks.
And everybody just used to watch and just think, are they sleeping together? Do you think? It was a lot of pressure.
British medal hopes, of course, rest with ice dancers Torval and Dean.
A 17-hour train journey from Munich brought Jane and Chris to Sarajevo and an 8:30 a.m. welcome from the world's press.
Suddenly there was a lot more press and media attention on us than in past years. There were people from The Sun and The Star and The Mirror that weren't really sort of ice skating orientated suddenly appeared.
But the endless scrutiny here of their every move and one slip in training has left them strangely tense and unsmiling.
It got to the point that even in the training sessions at Sarajevo, if one of us wobbled, it was on the front of the newspaper. They did Ravel's Bolero, as people used to call it when they'd seen it written down.
They are 4 minutes away from Olympic gold.
Bolero, Bolero or yes. Something, yeah?
Ravel's Bolero, you mean?
Ravel's Bolero, which was a beautiful bit of music. I remember a lot of purple and white and a look of sort of agony and pain and pleasure in their faces.
Bit of dragging around on the ice, bit of Ravel's Bolero, previously seen in 10 with Dudley Moore and Bo Derek. We knew what was going through their mind, it would have been enough to make the ice melt.
We felt it must have gone well because, we obviously were carried away by it ourselves. And then suddenly there was all these flowers on the ice, and we thought, oh, we've done it then. It's finished.
roars around the building, and the judges now just waiting for a moment to give the mark.
Well, when the scores came up for the first mark, which is a technical mark, it's very, very rare that anyone gets a six, because they say that nobody's ever perfect.
Let's see the second one. It's straight across the board! That's it! What a marvellous, marvellous set of marks!
And then the second set of marks came up, and they were all six, and we just couldn't believe it. It's just amazing.
No one has ever got a perfect mark from any of the Olympic judges in the compulsory ice dances, but they did today, and they made Olympic history.
They had six. They got a perfect score. It was a wonderful moment. Yeah, of course it was naff and crimpling and, you know, ice skating, go figure. But they won.
But that is a marvellous, marvellous end to this Olympic competition. Jane Torvill and Christopher Dean have won the gold medal of the 1984 Olympic ice dance competition.
Everybody started to have Torvill and Dean hairdos as well, which I think were the prototype to Lady Di's hairdo. We'll have a good time, baby.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sports Personality of the Year, Jane Torvill, Christopher Dean. Number 10, Bolero, by the Mike Reed Orchestra and Richard Hartley.
Well, I think it's one of those things you don't really admit that you'd actually watched Torvill and Dean. It's like, I suppose, watching Come Dancing or something, and thinking that you'd actually enjoyed the Latin section. But actually, I used to really love it.
They did it for Britain, little old England. We won some at last. Shame we can't win the bleeding football. Have a good time, baby, don't you worry.
And if we're still playing around... In 1984, three Canadian newspapermen became multimillionaires thanks to a board game they'd invented which took the world by storm. Now, Trivial Pursuits is a family favourite, and knowing the names of all the children in The Sound of Music can earn you the respect of your fellow man.
I can remember in 1984, Time magazine and a Time essay in the States described Trivial Pursuit as American social phenomena. Well, that was a little beyond what we ever envisioned for the game.
Trivial Pursuit was aspirational in all ways. It was aspirational to be able to finish a game within the space of a day. It was aspirational to be able to afford the game.
We never had it. We had Blankety Blank and Family Fortunes and crap games like that, you know.
And it was really fashionable to have Trivial Pursuit dinner parties.
But it weren't the same. You didn't have a pop dice. You know what I mean? That's what you want, a bit of fun, don't you? You know, you want to... It's all intellectual questions in that.
It made three men, three Canadian ex-journalists, incredibly wealthy.
I was working as a sports writer for the Canadian Press Wire Service out of Montreal, and Chris Haney, who was a photographer, and at the time he and his wife were out shopping one day, and he came back with a Scrabble game. And he said, you wouldn't believe what I paid for it, which in 1979 was something like $11 or $12, which he thought was outrageous. And he said, why don't we invent a game? What could it be about? And I said,
trivia?
Trivia. I sat down, grabbed a notepad or pencil, and he said, why don't you draw a circle? I said, I am. Huh? Now, from that point, once the circle's there, okay. What does a circle mean? Well, there must be a middle. Okay, if there's a middle, oh, there must be spokes connecting the middle to the outside. And that's really how it happened. We would tell people, listen, we have this game idea. We're forming a company. If you've got $1,000 to invest, invest it with us, and we think this thing will work. They are our special shareholders today. They are among the people who gave us the $40,000 that we needed to keep the process alive at the time. And the rest of them thought we were nuts. And they regret it.
And then, of course, you got your gold-plated playing pieces here.
Gold-plated what?
These guys became very, very rich. I think they're living in the Caribbean, and they design golf courses now.
A bit like Monopoly. If you played Monopoly by the real rules, you could probably start a game in 1960 and still be there now. Same with Triple Pursuit, really.
Mostly end with my mother, who's really bad at playing games, shouting at my father and saying that she was going to divorce him.
Answer the question, comrade, if you please. What was Julius Marx more commonly known as?
Karl?
No. Garoucho.
Because I went to college, I used to go home and try and hammer my parents, who never went to university, into the ground.
Well, here's one for your arms expert. What's that dude on Popeye's arm?
Sitting around going,
yeah, and here's a tough one.
No.
Oh, gentlemen, enough, please. The Star Wars question.
It was a no-alls game, wasn't it? It was for bigheads and braggarts and you know, and posers.
Who was Luke Skywalker's father?
If you said Dickens, and then they'd say, no, I want the first name, and if you couldn't remember, you obviously would remember Charles Dickens, but if you couldn't remember, and then they wouldn't give it to you if it was a piece of pie, and they'd always say, no, it's a piece of pie. I've got to have the exact answer on the question. I used to hate that.
Watch the day go by. If you told us in 1984, when we sold 19 million plus games, almost 20 million games in the United States alone, that we would be selling games 20 years later, we would have really questioned that.
It is embedded in our psyche, and it'll always be there, like Monopoly. I'm absolutely positive it'll be there in 100 years' time.
Trivial Pursuit, 6,000 questions of no vital importance whatsoever.
Might say my life is in a rut. I'm quite happy with what I got. People might say that I should strive for more, but I'm so happy.
The Jam had been one of Britain's top bands, but in 1984 Paul Weller had moved on and was heading off in a very different musical direction.
I think the Jam split up because Paul had reached a point where he really wanted to move on. The public gets
what the public wants. If he was still doing Jam songs nowadays, it'd be a real bore.
The Jam fans were just all the little punk rockers, weren't they? That's all they liked.
If you look at the Jam in terms of colour, the Jam were black and white, and the Style Council was colour. There was a lot of fun and a lot of humour, and he'd loosened up a lot on all levels, you know.
I just think there's endless possibilities.
Do you know what sort of possibilities? Do you have any distinct idea? Or do you take it as it comes?
No, it's a bit like a musical Kama Sutra, you know. I like that, don't you?
The Style Council, I thought, were utterly preposterous. The second part of the group's name, Council, seemed to really sum up Paul Weller to me, because if you think of the world of pop as being like politics, I've always thought of Paul Weller as being a small town councillor somewhere in a small Surrey town.
When he tried to, you know, just have a bit of fun, as it were, it kind of just really put people off. They never saw the humour in it, because they were just they were baffled by it a lot of the time.
Can I do an impersonation while I'm on here?
Why not? Do you want to do it now?
Which camera should I face? Is it on there?
Are there any agents watching this?
Viewers at home, see if you can guess who this is.
That was pretty good.
Yeah, Christopher Lee, that was.
The music wasn't so bad as the videos, in a way, you know, it was just, it did seem like, what is that all about, you know?
You know, I remember the Style Council wanted to be kind of like Italian cyclists, didn't they?
The thing is about the My Ever Changing video is that they were dressed in cycle tops, but that was a mod thing. You know, mods used to wear cycling tops, so it did have a definite kind of little mod influence in it. The Long Hot Summer video had Paul and Mick touching each other, and suddenly it was elevated into this kind of scandal, you know, these two guys who were touching each other. And that video was basically sent out like that, and the reaction to it was just proving their point. You know, so what if two guys go on a river and punt down Oxford and touch? So what? What's the problem? I remember actually Polydor were really worried about it, so Paul had another video made up of gay porn. and he inserted it in the middle and he sent it to the head of the company. So this, we've recut the video, this is the new one.
I was hopping mine, I was hopping mean, and as the rain came down I dropped to my knees and I prayed.
Of course it all looked a bit creaky. I actually think that out of Paul Weller's inability to be a French film star or a black American soul writer came some great music. Probably the finest he's ever written.
I was halfway home, I was half insane. I never shot window pilots, didn't just look the same.
At the same time, there was a jazz scene developing in London, so he kind of made a natural kind of link with them.
Each time it's spoken, there's a fragment.
I was sitting in a jazz shop and selling records, and then slowly and surely there'd be a trickle of soul boys coming in and ex-punks and people looking for a new direction in music. And that really reached its peak around 84 with the birth of Working Week.
The whole kind of pop jazz thing that I guess you can put Sade into and Style Council into and Working Week into and this whole little coterie of band, as much as anything, came from my record collection, and I don't mean that vainly, really.
It was one of the great early 80s moments, that when the cover of The Face had Robert Helms saying, you know, hey, have you heard this new music called jazz? You know, it's fantastic. You should hear Miles Davis, but you've never heard of him.
You'd go out on a Friday night to the Wag Club, which was another of the jazz nights, and you'd see Paul Weller, Sade, all the members of Working Week. These people were all in there. They were all in one room, and they're all kind of taking notes in the back.
The Wag was a great club. It was a great club. It was a great club to hang out.
It would seem a bit curious, actually, to be 19 and to be listening to music like this. The traditional idea is you listen to pop music.
There's just no good pop music about at the moment. That's the only reason. It's really bland.
I mean, it did get all a bit tossy, really. You know, guys with goatee beards and sort of Frank Spencer berets.
Well, people shouldn't be really walking around in zoot suits anyway, should they? It's not right. And it also cost money, you know, so it wasn't working class, so we didn't really think it was that cool. It cost money to wear all that sort of stuff, even the second-hand gear. You know, a tire cost you like £4, at least. So Robert Helms had single-handedly discovered jazz, and obviously, you know, there was Sade, and he dragged me down to the Wag Club because Sade was unsigned, and I was working at ZTT record label at the time, thinking, oh, I'll go and have a look.
Sade was my girlfriend. My name's Helen Fola Sade Adu. She's half Nigerian, girl from Clacton. Your love is key.
And Robert Helms was jumping around me like an excited rabbit. Look at this. Your love is key.
I mean, I'd been sitting there on the floor of our squat when all those songs were written. And I mean, it was literally a squat, and it, you know, out a loo on a balcony that used to freeze over.
And I picked out everything I hated about it: the bass player with his guitar up towards his chin, the sort of, you know, the ponderous quality of the whole thing.
This was a group of people with no musical training, no money, no anything else. It's almost like some kind of bad 1960s Cliff Richard film. They said, right, let's go and do the show, and they did it.
I rather grandly turned her down. And I never really told anybody later on that I'd done that, because within about 2 months she was possibly the most successful female singer in the world, you know. Your love is
king. No matter where you went in the world, you heard those songs. Every clothes shop, every party, every... anywhere. And I just used to, you know, you'd get in the back of a cab and it would be playing. It was an extraordinary time.
Inside. I loved the Sade style, actually, because suddenly it was like you knew if you saw her in a room she'd make you feel like you were wearing too much makeup.
How would you describe your image then?
I suppose it's fairly stark, but that's the only sort of, that's the only expression I can give to it. Diamond
love.
you look at her and she always went for that classical look and she always looked great, so she has no embarrassing photos of herself from the 80s.
Eyes, rather haughty.
Nice black hair, jet black hair, and like, she used to have it kind of like a slick back, you know, or like a bolero, you know, like Spanish style.
I don't like the sort of cliched idea of sophistication, you know, the black magic chocolate box version of it. I think people can be sophisticated in lots of different ways, and I think the idea of what sophistication is to me is somebody who feels right in what they wear.
So it was the jeans, the white shirt, that we thought was simple then, but actually if you see pictures of it, it's quite a flouncy white shirt. Most of all, the sort of, after all, 80s was about cocktails a lot, so it was in some sense like, this is the girl that would be the most beautiful girl on the bar, you know, ordering her cocktails.
Smooth operator. That girl's a smooth operator. No need to ask, he's a smooth operator. That was my theme tune for pulling. You know what I mean? I used to see the lady, right, from one end of the bar. Wouldn't know what I was going to say. Smooth operator just used to click on. And when it clicked on, that used to enable the flow to go. And even when I was talking to them, smooth operator was playing in my mind. It was rather romantic, really.
When Diamond Life, the first album, came out, everyone said, this is yuppie soul, as if somehow she had been this kind of supermodel who'd lived a life of luxury and made this record.
Well, I think I bought Diamond Life, you know, and I think it was, she seemed like a bit of an enigma, Sade, you know, and, you know, very beautiful, lovely voice, didn't sound like anything else. Great tunes on that first LP, you know.
And what an awful lot of the 80s was about people who had no money but had a huge desire. Sade was the absolute pinnacle of that.
The early 80s saw some bizarre fashions come and go. Let's not forget that once upon a time, pixie boots were acceptable for men and the mullet haircut was not a criminal offence. It's no surprise then that one of the biggest pin-ups of 84 was Michael Praed, who, as Robin of Sherwood, managed to add a medieval twist to contemporary fashions.
Oh, oh.
Robin, Robin, loaded man.
Robin of Sherwood.
Let's hear it for the boy. Let's give a boy.
Michael Praed, dark and handsome. My mother loved Michael Praed.
Michael's an extraordinary looking human being. I mean, he's one of the few men I've actually been with where he walks into a room and women just go.
It was like 5 o'clock ITV, you get comfy with a cup of tea and he'd be there with his hair on the right and on the back of the horse.
Michael became a huge hit with the teenage girls, and he had this rather fey quality, you know, which I also wanted from the Robin Hood, because he was in touch with the spirits and all that.
He was a perfect 80s hero, Michael Praed. Long hair, pale lip gloss,
beautiful hair, very very straight, centre parting down here, then very long at the back.
His hair, now that was interesting, wasn't it?
Luxurious crop.
It was, there was a sort of
nut-crushingly tight leathers.
Centre parting, and it was obviously very overwashed and conditioned because it had no life.
I imagine Robin of Sherwood must have had a huge gay following.
I'm not a serf. I'm a free man. I say you're a serf, you're a serf!
Yeah, whatever happened to Michael Praed? He sold his soul to Dynasty, didn't he?
And I think he was sort of Prince Molotov of Cocktail or somewhere, something silly like that.
And he told me later that, you know, you've got no direction at all. You had your tie straightened and your hair combed, but you had no direction. He said, I didn't know what I was doing, really. And he said, I felt a bit like a tailor's dummy.
in Dynasty, and he sort of hated it, quite frankly. Well, after Michael left the show, we were faced with the problem of replacing him, because the show was still very hot.
Then it got took over by Sean Connery's son, Jason.
Jason Connery. Oh, tiger.
Blonde. Looks a bit like David McCallum, a young David McCallum. Again, very attractive.
We're going to save them. And my father. Home will guide us.
He came down before we finished the end of the series with Michael. He came down and he just hung out with us. And we pulled all kinds of jokes on him and we ribbed him mercilessly. And he took it and he became part of the group.
Robin!
In America, there's still there's a Robin of Sherwood fan club as there is in the UK, but there's kind of these divisions, whether you're a Michael fan or a Jason fan, or, you know, did the show change? And it did change a little bit when Jason came along. I mean, all shows evolve, all shows change.
Action!
They started very early in the year, and it was absolutely freezing, getting up at sort of 4 a.m. to start shooting, and standing around on, you know, in the woods, in freezing conditions.
Stand back, stand!
Come on, this way, this way.
In one of the scenes, we had to walk up a river, and we were stood in this river, and there was literally, we were stood in the ice. There was ice literally flowing past our feet.
If you lived in a forest, you'd be covered in shit all the time, wouldn't you? It must be really dirty living in a forest.
See, they all stink.
But he looked lovely all the time, didn't he? He looked like he had, you know, silver crin rinse and his Lincoln green. Look at the arrow, my liege! They weren't living in the time. That was... No, I never watched it. Did you guess?
Got it! Oh!
Got it!
Somebody whacked the camera, sorry.
Men looking after each other, looking out for the poor, you know, steal from the rich, give to the poor. It was just, I loved it for that reason, I suppose.
I think it just shows the strength of the original legend, actually, that it's deep in everybody's psyche, the idea of being a rebel and sort of running around in the woods and keeping away from parking meters.
Robin Hood probably wasn't a real person.
Robin of Locksley. Locksley doesn't exist.
Which means that he might as well be a long-haired camp actor in leggings as anything else.
For those of us growing up in the 70s, a game was pretty straightforward. Monopoly, Cluedo, perhaps the odd hand of whist at Christmas. But in 1984, a darker, more sinister game was doing the rounds. Pale young boys would meet up to fight devils and demons, storm castles and creep through cellars as Dungeons and Dragons captured the imagination of the nation's spotty youth.
Under a blue moon I saw you, so soon you'll take me.
Now, D&D stands for Dungeons and Dragons, a fantasy game that's something of a cross between a hobby and a cult.
Comes back. I'm afraid, I'm going to attack you.
It gives children and grown-ups the chance to get away from it all, playing at being knights in shining armour, enchantresses, wizards, or medieval monks.
It was really interesting because, hey, it was like a game, but it wasn't like normal games. And so you'd have someone who knew all about it, who was a dungeon master. And you'd turn and you'd say, well, there aren't any real rules. And so, hey, great. I said, well, when do we start playing? Well, we're playing now, sort of thing. Well, was community chest in chance? Oh, no, hey, you're so 70s. That's not what Dungeons and Dragons is about at all.
Here it was, more of a designer game kit. You took on characters, elves, wizards, heroes, barbarians, thieves, by rolling dice to determine your characteristics. One of the players would also become the dungeon master, would create a labyrinth of rooms and passageways and populate those with monsters and treasure. And by role-playing, by conversation, interacting with the games master, you would go on these amazing adventures in the comfort of your own living room.
19.
He's hit it. That one slumps to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still your initiative, so are there any...
My cleric will come forward with his holy symbol in his hand and command them, in the name of all that's good and just, to return and repent their evil ways.
Okay, roll 2 6-sided dice.
12.
Yes, they all fall back.
And it was all about saying, no, you're going to be Vengor, god of the Stoat people, and you're going to be the king of the trolls.
You would become very fond of that character, and you'd really care about them. You wouldn't want them to die. It was an extension of you.
Turn for the worst. 9, just made it. It's 37.
Oh, yes, well done.
It was an intellectual game. It was a head game, basically.
Beneath the tablet's guileful form, revealed by true sight, is hid the pool envisaging.
It sounds very funny now, but people become absolutely obsessed and would play for like 48 hours in a row as they got deeper and deeper into the adventure.
A typical Dungeons & Dragons player would be the kind of kid that didn't really get out much, didn't really do a lot of sports, tended to avoid going on games days and would sneak off to behind the back of the canteen and play Dungeons & Dragons with his mates.
Was a big deal in Tales, but I thought people got girlfriends.
And for those too young or too busy to take part in a Dungeons & Dragons marathon, a series of game books were launched in 1984. They proved popular with school kids, keen to beat up a few monsters before bedtime.
The Secret of Firetop Mountain is yours, together with the second book in the best-selling fighting fantasy series by the phenomenally successful Steve Jackson and Ian Livingston.
When Steve and I wrote the fighting fantasy game books, we had no idea, and Penguin certainly had no idea, just how big they would become.
There were those books that were like, hey, keen on Dungeons & Dragons but got no friends, then get this book and you can do it yourself.
You find yourself in a fiendish tunnel. Suddenly you hear a noise behind you.
And I think you had to go like, you are in a tunnel. There is a door at the end of the tunnel. What do you want to do? And there was never the option. Nothing. There was, so like, go through or retreat. And then turn to page 162. You are dead.
We had loads of criticism at first, but again, that's like anything new. The immediate thing is to hate it, ban it, certainly misunderstand it. So there was an 8-page warning guide published by the Evangelists, and apparently some woman in deepest suburbia wrote into some radio show saying that having read one of my books, her child had levitated. The rest of the population, the kids were saying, wow, for £4 I can fly, I'll have some of that. So they go out and buy them even bigger numbers. But of course that was all rubbish, and I still can't fly today.
Now, you wouldn't have thought there was much wrong with the classic teddy bear, loved by generations, a symbol of all that's good about the British childhood. But in 1984, kids left the traditional bear behind, and from across the Atlantic came a new breed, pastel blue, green and yellow, their stated mission to make kids play in a caring way.
Care Bears lived in a place called Care-a-lot. It was a sort of mythical place, probably in the sky.
There was no introduction of domestic violence or theft or anything in Care Bear Land.
They were different colours, though, which marked them apart from each other initially. But then they had these icons, these patches on their stomach, and the children were really into those because those were the things responsible for giving them their names.
Wish Bear was turquoise with a shooting star on its stomach for wishful thinking. Grumpy Bear was dark blue with a rain cloud to show that even though you can be miserable, it's better to be happy. Love-a-lot Bear was pink with a range of hearts on his stomach to show that it's better to share love.
Remember, sharing is a sure way to keep cool.
They drove around in cloud cars.
Moving fast and bright as a firefly.
Which, after Knight Rider, if you're thinking as a girl looking for the role model, we had a talking car that was indestructible. What did girls have? A cloud car.
Importantly, they were collectible because of the insignia. Children wanted more than one, whereas in the past they would have bought one soft toy. Now they could suddenly have one Care Bear, its friends, its best friends, its other friends, its relations, and a whole collection of the Care Bears.
Welcome to our treehouse, Level Up Bear. You too, Sunshine Bear.
And they had millions of them. They had Lucky Bear and this bear, and you could make them sit down. They always had hearts on their bottoms and hearts on their feet. Look, that's quite sweet.
Good Luck Bear was a dark green bear with a clover on his stomach.
Okay. Lucky about that, is there? Lucky about that.
Unlike a lot of other toys around that time, you could buy all sorts of Care Bears merchandise, from clothes to duvets and sporting goods and mugs and pens and stationery. The list was almost endless.
You're a shamrock, aren't you, Irish?
Making lots of money out of merchandise now. Breaking it in hand over fist. No one knows in about 10 years. Me and my little pony be on her ass.
But there was no worse than meeting someone and going, right, I've met a career woman. I'm in a relationship here that could go places, and then you go back with them and you can't get on the bed for Care Bears.
Yeah, I really like Care Bears. Look, he's quite... Can I have this? Why? He's cute.
You know, they've got a big suit there for you to put on, you know, and it's like, could you put that on? I don't think we should rush it and go to bed. Could you just hug me and love me and be my friend and build a cloud car?
Care Bears countdown.
And send a wish out through the air.
And send a wish out through the air. Just do that Care Bears countdown.
Just when you need them, they'll be there.
In 1984, daffodils were on the top of many student shopping lists. The reason? The rise to fame of a sensitive flower called Morrissey and his band of Smiths.
I used to know Stephen Morrissey because in the punk days, you know, 77, 78 in Manchester, there was quite a vibrant little circuit, and Morrissey was a strange little character on the edge of it all.
Stephen was the bespectacled nerd at the back of the gig.
He was not unlike Roy out of Coronation Street. He seemed a little bit retarded. You were a bit worried about him.
He then rang me up, probably in about 1980, to say could I go and see him. So I went out to see him at his mum's house, and I went into the set in his bedroom, lined with James Dean's pictures, and he announced to me that he was going to decide, I'm going to be a pop star. And I remember sitting there thinking, why the hell you are, Stephen?
So I heard the name The Smiths, and that Stephen Morrissey was in it. And it just sounded like too quirky and too eccentric to really matter. And then I heard This Charming Man, and I could not believe it.
The Smiths, to me, were the most brilliant Manchester band of all time, and still are.
Anybody who could wear a hearing aid, an Elvis t-shirt, and have a quiff like that, roll about on the floor with flowers in his back pocket, now that's a pop star, you know. Ricky Martin, my ass.
Why can't the life's complexity when the leather runs smooth on the passenger seat?
For me, they were like all the worst episodes of Coronation Street. I mean, Morrissey was just Ina Sharples. Just kept moaning in this dreary, rather camp northern voice.
This man said it's crucial that someone so handsome should care.
People criticised him saying all the miserable and all this, but they were really funny. Fantastic lyrics, Morrissey.
I'd like to drop my trousers to the world. I am a man of means, of slender means. Each household appliance is like a new science in my town.
I feel that I write with humour, and I never get recognition for this, but when people say Morrissey is so miserable, to me it's just a lazy journalism, it's just a very surface opinion.
I couldn't stand the Smiths, no, not at all. I was a rock fan, and I was into hedonism and escapism. I loved rock and hip-hop, and the Smiths gave all of us lots something to kick against, really, you know, because they were such moaning minis, the lot of them, really.
Yeah, the miserable Smiths fans, and the miserable Smiths, well, they weren't miserable when we were playing. The gigs were like football matches, and that quickly. You know, even in the small gigs, it was just chaos.
You
you'd see sort of concerts years ago where people would just be going to any lengths to climb onto that stage and like throw their arms around them.
I was in Derby working there, and the old Grey Whistle Test were filming the Smiths live in concert at the Assembly Rooms in Derby. And these coaches from Manchester come down. There were about 400 people in the audience, and it was absolutely wild. You'd never seen anything like it. All throwing like daffodil stems.
It got a bit treacherous in the end, the flowers thing, because the stage was so goddamn slippy. You know, I'd be wearing moccasins, and you'd be thinking, oh, you know, you're getting down with your bad self. The next thing, whoa, a tulip, bang.
I remember going to Smith's concerts, and you get there and there would be thousands of people with, you know, big huge quiff, national health glasses, a hearing aid, and, you know, big sort of flowery shirts or Smith's t-shirts, whatever. I mean, all looking absolutely identical.
And he helped us all because we could all go to secondhand shops, Oxfam, and get cheap old blouses and stuff and wear those. Never wore a hearing aid, never wore national health glasses for a laugh.
Morrissey style ran kind of parallel to mine in a way, without sounding too sort of contrived about it. We were in a retro Levi's, which at that time were actually were not really that expensive.
Now you have gone, and you must be looking very old tonight. The devil will find work for idle hands to do.
He'd look cool now, you know, he wore faded denim 501s, you know, in a white shirt that was always open, and he always used to have his hand on his chest and be doing all this kind of thing. You'd be like, oh.
He was just like a stick, wasn't he? He was really thin and had nothing to him. His body just went like that.
He was kind of adopted by really privileged middle-class students as their great hero, because, you know, they'd always dreamed, I suppose, of being genuinely downtrodden and hard done to. And, of course, these people had an incredible lifestyle, but really just wanted something to moan about.
Oh, the devil will find work for idle.
For me personally, I feel like I'd always been a bit of a weirdo. I was always the one that got bullied at school, bullied where I lived. I was living on a big council estate, and things were sort of pretty bleak, and then Morrissey came along, basically the Smiths came along, kind of saying, I'm a weirdo too, we're weirdos, and join our gang and you'll be okay. And I just ended up choosing William It Was Really Nothing and writing a play based around the song.
At the tender age of 15, he wrote his first play, William, in 2 hours, and it's just finished a successful run at the Royal Court Theatre in London. Since we're short of staff, we sent a bit of a prat on to interrogate this budding young genius.
I was going up to Newcastle to do an interview on the Tube. I got a phone call from the Tube and said, by the way, we thought, you know, we should let you know, Morrissey said that he'd like to do the interview himself, he'd like to interview you.
How do you find the first months of fame?
Well, I'm enjoying them immensely. It's just really, really exciting.
Fame is very important to you, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, as I don't want to die and be no one. You see me meaning?
I do indeed.
Yes.
I can't bear to look back on the interview. It kind of makes me cringe because I got it so wrong, and I was sort of young and spotty and wearing a jumper that I borrowed off of my uncle and everything, and it was just really, I can't bear to watch it.
Jolly good show.
And can I ask you a question, Roy?
Yes.
What have the Smiths been doing recently?
The very standard group things. We've been in the studio and we've recorded a new single.
When I look back, it's like a bit of a fairy tale, really. It's not the sort of thing that happens to 16-year-olds.
In 1984, a toy emerged which would mesmerize a generation of school kids. Transformers had their own cartoon series, comic and film. The robots in disguise were everywhere.
You could never forget it, could you, really? And the robot voice, robots in disguise.
Even Decepticons! Autobots, transform!
Transformers, robots in disguise.
A transformer is basically a vehicle that transforms, hence the name, into a robot of some kind, and then can transform back to the car, ad infinitum. usually through a complex chain of twists and turns that only a seven-year-old can do. I mean, adults have never been able to do these things.
It was the Pokemon of 1984.
Transformers are a melding of two great toy ideas. We all know kids love cars and planes. We also know they have loved robots, so Transformers was just, you know, great, well, let's put both those ideas together.
That fascination with being able to do it and showing off on the playground, almost a la Rubik's Cube, was something that made them an instant hit with kids.
Heroic Autobots versus evil Decepticons with the fate of planet Earth hanging in the balance. Transformers.
The main story of Transformers was really a civil war on a faraway planet populated by robots, which, by accident, spreads to our world.
Optimus Prime, do you read me? The Decepticons are blitzing Autobot City.
And their sort of battle between the good guys, who are the Autobots, and the Decepticons, who are the evil, nasty pieces of work, continues. And they're forced to disguise themselves as Earth-based vehicles to try and blend in.
The best-known Transformers were Optimus Prime and Megatron, because they were the leader of the different sides. Optimus was the Autobot leader.
The leader and battle headquarters of the heroic Autobots is Optimus Prime.
Optimus Prime turned from a robot into a truck, or a truck into a robot.
Optimus Prime,
Transformers, robots in disguise.
I wanted Optimus Prime. He was ginormous and cost a lot, so I couldn't have him.
They must save Earth.
Evil Decepticons.
Optimus Prime was so scarce it was untrue, and he became the must-have Transformer in those days.
Optimus Prime, we need you.
Transformers,
robots in disguise.
There'd be whispers around the classroom. Oh, he's got the new Power Master Prime. Oh, wow. So you'd meet up in the playground somewhere, or you'd meet up over the hut on the field, and you'd all get your Transformers out.
And there was one that was a gun and then would turn into a big robot.
Robots in disguise.
And then there was one that was a tape cassette.
Soundwave was another of Megatron's lieutenants, and he turned into a rather nifty-looking tape recorder.
Optimus Prime.
But how the hell could being a tape cassette actually be of any use as a robot?
The rest of them, you know, they turn into motorbikes, cars, vroom, vroom. This one turned into a cassette and just lie around hoping that someone's a fan of Chris de Burr.
A little travelling music, Dinsmore.
It's always easy to say that, well, anybody who sort of followed something that was a toy 16 years ago through to, you know, adulthood, you know, there's a temptation to tag it sad. I'd rather not sad, just like I say, dedicated.
You do get some people that take it a little bit too seriously. I run conventions. I'm extremely interested in Transformers, but I do know when it stops.
It's a bit of a sad thing for boys to do, really, be obsessed by that. I wasn't obsessed.
Now, movie actor is right up there with footballer, model and Elton John's florist as a job we'd all settle for. But getting a major role in a top film is no easy achievement these days. But in 1984, things were different. There was one surefire way that every Hollywood actor knew of getting their face onto the silver screen. Become a big mate of Emilio Estevez.
Andrew McCarthy was the one I loved.
Judd, the one with the big eyes and the nose like that.
Molly Ringwald.
Rob Lowe.
Ali Sheedy. Demi Moore.
They were the Brat Pack, they were really cool, they were the big thing in the 80s, and I wanted to be one of them.
The Brat Pack were a group of young actors who made a series of films together, including 16 Candles, The Breakfast Club, and St. Elmo's Fire.
I mean, St. Elmo's Fire was a hit, big hit movie, and it was terrible. I mean, just really ridiculously bad. And if you look at it now, it's a camp classic.
Jules, where are you getting the money for all this? Why do you think God invented credit?
I mean, it's not a real social study of young guys in America. I don't think. I don't think it was intended for that.
It's a bit of fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Go have a laugh.
I had the advantage of knowing Rob Lowe from a very young age. He grew up in the same neighborhood as I did. And so there was that rapport already going. Once we all assembled, we started the rehearsal period, everyone seemed to want to create that environment. They wanted to create that chemistry.
Hey, I've been an amateur gynecologist for years.
Hey, Billy is great.
Unbelievable.
What they represent is the new generation of would-be Hollywood stars, of whom quite a few have suddenly emerged. To some extent, the term Brat Pack, which lumps them all together like the hole-in-the-wall gang, is a media invention or a bit of Hollywood hype.
Well, I coined the phrase, the Brat Pack, while sort of searching for a shorthand way to describe what I'd experienced with these guys and what they were like.
Excuse me, sir, we do not open until 11.
That's cool, I'll wait.
Emilio Estevez, at the time, had done a number of John Hughes films and become pretty successful, and he was dating Demi Moore at the time.
I have to find a lovely table for you and your guests. But
I came out to Los Angeles and we met and we really hit it off and said, you know, well, hey, why don't you come out with my friends? And they were at the center table and being as loud and sort of obnoxious as they could possibly be to draw even more attention to themselves than they would already get just being famous.
Somebody give me a screwdriver
and a hammer.
They hated the phrase, hated me, attacked me endlessly, everywhere they could.
Not writing for the paper would make it.
I don't really think it's a valid thing. I mean, we all don't go to the same bar every night and talk about chicks and, you know, throw back a few brews. I mean, I don't think it exists, per se.
So it's a bit exaggerated in a way, too?
Yeah, I just think it's easy to lump people together, so that's what they do.
The Breakfast Club's actually not a bad movie.
You know, you've got the Sportle, what is it, the athlete, you've got, what's it, the brain, the nutcase, the criminal, the princess, all held together on Saturday morning for detention.
Well, well, here we are.
The thing about it was, they had the life that you thought you wanted to have at school. Even detention was the best fun you could have.
And I wanted to go into detention after that, and I did a few times going into detention. It was never